If you'd like to know why describing wine is so hard for us to do, then you're going to love this interview.
I'm here with Alex Gapinski, and I had the most fascinating wine tasting with Alex. I was visiting a winery where he works in Wisconsin, of all places, the La Bellezza. And all of a sudden, little did I know that the person pouring the wines for the tasting behind the counter had so much information. You were this wealth of knowledge that I found super fascinating. So, Alex, first thing that I want you to describe is your background.
So I've been interested in food for a very long time and ended up with a degree in food science from the University of Minnesota in the Twin Cities. During that time, I went to France and had gotten introduced to wine there. And so I decided to do an extra semester of some culinary and wine courses. So I'm a certified wine professional by St. Paul College. I went ahead and did the level 2 award in wine and spirits.
One of the things that I loved about our conversation was that you finally explained to me something that has been a mystery for so long, which is, why is it we're tasting wine, we're enjoying it, we're loving it, we're having this experience of it, but the second somebody says, describe the wine or put words to it, it's like, like even for me who's been working in this business for over 20 years, it's still like, really hard. So can you tell me more about that?
One of the primary reasons that it's so difficult to associate language with what we're smelling or taste is that it's two different parts of our brain. They're really not that close. So you've got your little smell center over here, and you've got your taste center here, and then your language center is over here. They're not hooked up to really talk to each other.
Like California and New York or something.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Smell in our taste centers works a little bit differently than ours. And being able to learn how to do that and train your brain how to do that is one of the fun things about wine tasting.
Okay. So now you've piqued my curiosity. You got to tell me, like, how do I do it? What are the steps to be able to do that better?
Another thing to think about before we get started is with smells, we don't have specific words for each smell. We always resort to analogy. Lots and lots of these different compounds floating around in wine, and we don't know those compounds as the compounds. So we have to say, well, what does that smell like? Does it smell like a blackberry or a blueberry or a fresh strawberry? We're always making a comparison. So one of my tips that I've heard a few different places is to go out and just smell things. But you've got to pay attention and kind of make a connection, mental note, say, okay, this is what cumin smells like. How is that different from cinnamon? And so being able to pull those things out in a wine is a challenge.
That is so fascinating. It's kind of like creating a little map for your brain and smelling it and saying the word, or maybe reading it if you're visual or whatever, and making just that connection, like mapping it together.
Gordon M. Shepard, the author of that neurogastronomy, he also has a book called Neuroenology, which just kind of focuses the same things but towards wine tasting, came up with this concept of a smell image and tries to describe what that is. So as an example, my fiance and I were having this bottle of Zinfandel, and she goes, and she's not a wine, she'll tell you she's not a wine person, but she goes, this smells like we're out picking strawberries with grandma, and grandma's wearing her dusty velvet dress.
I love that.
You know, very specific, which we've been strawberry picking with my grandma. I don't think she has a velvet dress. That's probably not dusty. But, you know, that was kind of describing how the wine tasted, and that, like, if you've heard the term of dusty tannins, and then just fresh strawberries, and just kind of this, I don't know, sentimental image that came to mind. So
that's the best part about wine, the way it transports you.
One of the big things that I've heard a lot discussed is minerality in wine. To me, it's, you know, maybe a little bit saline, salty. I think of rocks, but if you go out and smell rocks, rocks don't smell because they don't have any compounds that are volatile that you can breathe in through your nose and they they don't interact with your olfactory senses. So this concept of minerality, when I think of that as a smell image, is when I'm smelling a wine, what image comes to my brain?
Okay, so actually you gave me an idea, and it's a good moment to just like plug my business, Life in Vino. We do virtual online wine tastings like this, where I'll go on and I'll do a tasting session. So you have just inspired me. I will do one of the next tastings on minerality, and I'll tell people maybe like 3 or 4 different wines that have minerality, and they can get them and we can taste them together. And I think that would be a really good example of how tasting with an expert, tasting with someone who's knowledgeable, you can learn so much than just trying to taste and identify it on your own. So you're getting me back to what else I can do to improve this skill, this muscle of being able to describe the wines.
In addition to going out and smelling things and building that verbal repertoire, break it down. Just kind of slow down and think, well, what am I smelling? Forget that it's wine in your glass and just think, what am I smelling? You're trying to find what's in the wine. And yes, it's only wine in there. The same chemical compounds that make up the smell of a strawberry are also present in, say, Zinfandel. That's why you can smell strawberries in Zinfandel. In technical terms, taste is only the sense that we get from our tongue. Mm-hmm. And we have 5 basic tastes: salty, sweet, umami, sour, and bitter. Only 5. That's it.
No bananas.
Another one of our 5 basic senses is touch. So tannins, when you're discussing tannins in a wine, usually come into the sense of touch. So it's sight, taste, touch, hearing. There's a French, I can't remember all the details of it, but they called it the glue glue. It was the mouth, or the swooshing of the mouth, the wine in your mouth, and how that plays into our perception of wine and our enjoyment of wine. It's very much a part of it. If all of a sudden that was taken away, you kind of wonder what was going on, and am I drinking wine, or, you know, what's happening? I've also heard that, you know, one of the best sounds in the world is the pop of a cork and that first splash into a glass. That's all part of it, and the enjoyment of wine and food. So what's the last one? Smell. It's the largest set of genes in our genome that make up for our smell receptors. So line of defense as an animal is if something that we're going to nourish ourselves with, we are going to put that into our body. We need to know if it's safe. So we learn what those smells are. Does it smell like, you know, a nice fresh strawberry or a moldy strawberry that might have been sitting, you know, somewhere for too long? We take those cues. So
that's fascinating.
Lots of different combinations.
I'm going to extrapolate from that and say that the more wine tasting you do and the more distinctions you're able to perceive, you're actually more survivable in the world, because really this all comes back to a basic survival instinct of being able to differentiate all these smells and knowing what's safe and what's not. So how does experiencing the wine that way and thinking about it that way, how does that relate to being able to translate it into language and communicating and therefore describing wine?
Well, breaking it down helps you think about the different parts of the process, of course. So when I said we're breathing in and you've got those little molecules tumbling around, and they fit into our olfactory receptors, our smell receptors, in a different way. That's kind of where our light bright analogy takes off. That's that pattern of smell molecules coming from that specific wine makes a pattern on those and sends those signals up to our brain. But then if you slow it down and you think, okay, there's more to that pattern can change a little bit for that same wine. So when we taste it, we get another piece of that pattern. So when you're talking about the grid, you go down there, then you get deeper and deeper into the complexity of a wine. There's this concept called sensory-specific satiety. is where repeated exposures, you become less satisfying. It's less satisfying to keep exposing yourself to something. And that's why with food and wine pairing, like if your food, if you keep eating food, it's not going to be as satisfying. You're not going to enjoy that meal as much as if you interrupt it with a little wine. Say a little food, a little wine, a little food, a little wine. So when you're thinking about thoughtful food pairings, food wine pairings, you're trying to match those or contrast them in a specific way to maximize your enjoyment of the experience.
Cool. So fascinating. It's basically like the science of pleasure and enjoyment.
I'm going to expand on that by quoting from this book called Taste by Barb Stuckey. I came prepared. I put all my books here.
I love it. I love the visuals.
But her definition of an expert, the book is called Taste. So you're thinking about food and wine. But Baba Shiv says an expert is someone who knows how to derive maximum pleasure from the consumption experience. Learning about wine tasting really well.
Oh, that is so, so brilliant. I need to get that quote from you. I need to put it everywhere in my life because that for me is what it's all about. Like, I don't care to know a lot of facts to impress people about wine, but it's just about how can I enjoy it the most and how can I inspire other people and kind of infect them with this passion for wine too. And so that's why I spend a lot of my time in my business. I do these free online wine tastings that people can join from anywhere in the world and we'll taste the wine together and we'll go through that because I really think that when you learn to do that, you start to learn the art of appreciating the wine, but you start to really appreciate all of your life and relish all the little pieces of it more.
Just paying attention to what's happening around you can really give you extra pleasure in life. So,
oh my God, this is so great, Alex. Thank you so, so much. I learned a lot and I just thought it was super fascinating. So I'm glad we got to share that with other people too.
Yeah, thanks very much for having me.